Welcome back to the Things Academy. So we got a new program in store for you, and today we're gonna dive into LoRaWAN devices. So there's so many devices out there, and actually you can purchase lots of devices off the shelf, but what we're gonna do today is we're gonna create our own firmware, we're gonna create our own application where you sense your environment using sensors and send that data over LoRaWAN. So before we dive into that workshop, I first want to say a few things about devices. So I'll give you a bit of a theoretical background before we dive into the workshop. And this workshop is hosted by Sebastian Romero. He's working at Arduino as one of the engineers, and he will explain how to set up your Arduino development environment and how to program your device to start sending data. So once you set up your device, we have JP Myers joining in, and he's gonna host a session on range and range testing. So he's the creator of the application called TTN Mapper, and it's a widely used application for testing the range of your gateways. And we're gonna use his tool to basically learn how to read the metadata that's provided in the ThingStack. So we're gonna read and look at the radio signal strength as well as the signal to noise ratio. And by looking at the data, we'll learn how to draw conclusions from it to design the ideal network coverage. Before we dive in this content, I first have a short interview with Scott Waller. Scott Waller is one of our partners. He's based in Seattle in the US, and he's an experienced IoT engineer as well as an entrepreneur. So we're going to talk with him about what he did to set up his business and what skills he thinks are required to start a business such as Thingy. Enjoy. So welcome back to the Things Academy. Thanks a lot for joining in, and I'm honored to have a short interview with Scott Waller. Scott is based in Seattle. He is the CEO and founder of a IoT integration company. It's called Thingy. Scott, do you want to introduce yourself shortly?
Yeah, you bet. Well, I mean, you already got the background on that. So yeah, Scott Waller, CEO and co-founder of Thingy. My other partner is actually down in Australia. And yeah, we're a IoT LoRaWAN-based integrator, carrier, as well as a solution builder. So we actually have our own set of sensors that we build as well. But yes, based out of sunny Seattle.
Nice, nice. So what kind of sensors are you building?
So most of the stuff we're focusing on, so the sensors that we actually got our start and where Thingy got its name was a wildfire or air quality sensor. And so we partnered with a wildfire challenge. It was a sensor challenge put on by the Environmental Protection Agency at the US government. U.S. Forest Service, NASA, and other agencies, and they put this challenge out there. And, you know, we were sensor builders, tinkers, weather station providers. At the time, we were working at Cisco. And so, you know, large career in tech. And we said, hey, let's go after this. I was a volunteer firefighter for a handful of years. And so it seemed like a fun challenge to solve of taking air quality sensors that are usually $40,000 to $50,000 that the local authorities might put out there, how do we get more of them and distribute them closer towards the communities, like in rural communities, but bring the cost down with some of the new IoT sensor technology? And so we went after it in 2017, and we were one of the finalists and got a little grant out of it, and we've been improving it ever since. Nice. But it's been fun to, you know, as the smoke here in the Seattle area and, you know, all across the West Coast of the United States is getting really bad, and I'm hearing now it's getting bad in Europe. There's a need for higher density amounts of sensory, specifically for air quality. And the cool part is since day one, we've been using LoRaWAN as the telemetry method to communicate that almost in real time.
Yeah, nice. Because there are quite some wildfires in that region. Is that the reason for initiating this project?
Yeah, it's a little bit of both. One of them, there's the human health aspect. When we have local authorities saying, hey, stay inside or go outside, the air is unhealthy for maybe asthmatic patients or sensitive patients. You know, that's one part of it, but where we actually saw the application was in agriculture. You have crops that are out there. Think of wine grapes and hops and apples and blueberries that they're subjected to the smoke and the particles and all the bad stuff that's in the air for a long period of time. And the agronomists of the world are getting concerned that it's actually affecting the crops in a bunch of different ways. And so we spend a lot of time working in the ag industry of the application of air quality sensors as maybe an early warning system or a decision-making criteria of what they want to do with their harvest. And it's an interesting application we never thought about, but it's growing as the smoke frequency and the density of it happens more and more here.
Yeah, very exciting. So how where did you start? Did you start from scratch, or was there some kind of development board you build your sensors on top of?
I think there's a little bit of both, right? Is you know, if we look back 5 years, there was a bunch of little Arduino development boards that are out there. And I think between the MCUs and the radios, there's a limited subset of either development boards that were already available or subcomponents that you could hack together and, you know, tie a bunch of leads and do a little bit of soldering. And next thing you know, you have a little Arduino board that's transmitting a LoRaWAN frame every couple of minutes based on a sensor value, maybe your temperature or humidity. Yeah. You know, now we have the likes of ST bringing out the STEM32WL, a dual core universal MCU plus radio. But I think, you know, what you guys have done and others are building in these dev platforms, it makes it a little easier, supply chain constraints aside, that we're having right now. But, you know, the lot has matured, and what was available 5 years ago versus now, I mean, you have way more in your toolbox to be able to build solutions from scratch.
Exactly. So you used LoRaWAN from the start. Can you say a bit more about why you used LoRaWAN and maybe, why LoRaWAN, why not other technologies?
Correct. So I started doing a bunch of sensor technology in ski resorts, and I do a bunch of avalanche safety warning systems. If you're out there in the backcountry around the world and you see an RU beeping sign, that's my stuff. I've been building that for years and deploy sensors all over the world. Well, with that, and you're in the backcountry in really remote locations, you may or may not have cellular to be able to connect that device to the internet to get some type of insights, whatever you want to do. You know, I had been doing Zigbee and Beely mesh and all the different FSK things in the past over the years, and they just never, you basically had to customize everything, write a bunch of microcode, build your own radios, and then power became a serious problem. I have to put larger solar panels at some of these locations. And once LoRaWAN came out, really just the LoRa modulation itself, we started doing LoRa point to point and kind of building our own little mesh or repeater. And then once it really took hold, you know, all the manufacturers in Europe, some of the new startups in the US and abroad, once the ecosystem of sensors started and the radio technology was, you know, the regulations and everything else that went with it, now you have an entire ecosystem that it's the perfect medium to be able to put a gateway at the top of a ski resort with a gateway on top of a mountain that covers an entire agriculture valley. And now I have an ecosystem of sensors I can build upon, whether it's something I want to build custom that is not in the market already, or something that's already out there. No need to reinvent the wheel when someone else has done the R&D time to build the sensor. But you can add that sensor in an open ecosystem that in the end, the data comes out nicely modeled, and it's easy to add those together to create, you know, greater value in the data.
Yeah. So basically all of your first projects, you installed the sensor and you installed the gateway with it to make sure it has that right coverage.
Correct. Hold on 1 second. Well, we might need to do a new take on that. That was an IoT sensor that decided to wake up. It was my Roomba that decided to clean.
Oh, was it?
It's nice. Not using LoRaWAN. It has a mind of its own. It decides to start at about 9 a.m. every morning, and I forgot about it.
Perfect. Well, no worries. We'll see if we cut it out. Great. So, let's look back. So you set up this sensor, and you set up this gateway along with it. But this can become pretty costly, isn't it? If you have a sensor and always have to go, like, install that sensor as well as, like, bring a gateway along.
Correct. And it depends on where you're at. What we're starting to see, actually, when I met, I think it was 2019, when I met with Vinca and Johan, they were actually out here in Seattle, and we were trying to figure out in the U.S. market, where is LoRaWAN going to really take hold? I mean, obviously, Europe, there's plenty, you know, Europe and Australia and others, TTN's taken hold. You know, you got the private carriers that have provided LoRaWAN type services that are out there. But in the United States, it doesn't really exist. It's pretty disaggregated. And so one of the challenges, how do we cost effectively build these networks in the areas to solve the discrete problems? Where's the greatest value and return on putting gateways and infrastructure out there? Over the past couple of years, it's grown exponentially. You got more and more, whether it's community ag groups that are building and investing in the infrastructure, whether it's on TTN itself, or you know, you have the likes of Senate and other carriers that are incentivizing others to go build those networks. And the more and more of these networks we build together, and the more that we can use things like, you know, the packet broker and roaming to be able to stitch those networks together, then eventually we'll have some really good coverage in certain areas like the ag producing regions. So yes, it's an expensive investment, but also, you know, when I was at Cisco, the LoRaWAN gateway was $3,000. Those prices are all coming down. You have very small, you know, single and four and eight channel outdoor gateways now that are sub $500 that have LTE as backhaul. And that's perfect for these kind of micro installations. But, you know, especially in agriculture, we're able to cost effectively put that out there in an area, put it on top of a mountain, cover an entire valley. And the great thing about farmers is they talk to each other. And so once someone has a sensor solution, let's say measuring irrigation or microclimates or frost, next thing you know, the next guy wants it. And you're able to, you know, kind of capitalize on that initial investment you put out there. But initially, yes, it's always, you know, you're kind of breaking through in an area that doesn't have coverage. And so you have to make that investment. So how do you do it in a cost effective way is the challenge.
Yeah. Well, I think that's also part of being an entrepreneur, that you first like have to do an investment at the beginning, but eventually, like, maybe more centers come in, maybe collaborate with others, maybe have more customers in that region that makes it worth the investment.
Correct. But I think it's really finding the right use case to solve. I see in IoT in general, too many companies say, hey, we're gonna do everything. We're gonna have every sensor that's out there, we're gonna provide every service. And they're trying to solve every problem and just say LoRaWAN is the solution to all problems. That's not the right way to approach it. You'll never actually get the right customers, get them to bite on the one thing that is a business imperative problem that you have to solve. What is the business value to that customer? And it's really honing in on what the challenge is. So if I go back to smoke, our sensor. So smoke is bad to wine grapes, very bad. We've partnered with researchers at the universities and the wine commission, the Department of Agriculture, and the growers and the producers of wines, and collectively brought research together to say, hey, we don't all know what's going on, but hey, we have some sensors that we can start deploying along with LoRaWAN. Next thing you know, they go, well, we want some microclimate and some weather stations to go with it. So, you know, what it's come to is in a couple of weeks, I'm installing 50 gateways and sensors all the way down the coast from Washington all the way down to Napa wine country. Mm-hmm. And we're going to build upon that, right? So we've got, you know, investment dollars coming in from research organizations and universities, along with the growers and producers. It's a different way of doing things versus just saying, hey, I have this sensor and try to go sell it to everyone.
We're really
taking a more collaborative approach that I think it's, in a niche market where it's very unique, but also, you know, you have farmers, you have to know your customer, what they really want, and you have to solve that one problem, then you could build upon it. We find that a unique solution to solve and go after it.
But eventually you're only measuring the smoke particles, right? Like how does that relate to eventually the business case for farmers?
So, you know, this it's not just particles. So we're actually gathering kind of the signatures of smoke. So we spent a lot of time over the last couple of years with our smoke sensor characterizing smoke. So we've built data sets that we can understand the components of smoke. Smoke has particles in it of different sizes. Yeah. It has gases in it, has carbon monoxide, mm-hmm. dioxide, ozone, et cetera, et cetera. And we're able to characterize that over different fuel types. Is this sagebrush in a farm? Is this, you know, a Doug fir tree? Is this range grass? Is this a diesel truck sitting next to, idling next to a sensor and putting off particulates that are unique to diesel? So we're able to actually develop signatures now and then apply that to when the researchers say, hey, we think this is the type of smoke that causes this chemical change in the actual, you know, chemical and biological change in the grapes and the wine.
Yeah.
Well, if we can figure out an early warning system that directly correlates to that based on the smoke contents, then we have a direct tie-in to what's meaningful. So maybe an early warning system, maybe a prediction system. There's a bunch of different things that, you know, are bound in research, but it's just applying sensory technology to solve the problem. And then, you know, a lot of these chemists don't have access to these sensors and the technology that are meant to be deployed on a battery in the middle of nowhere with a long range radio. So we're solving both problems, both the right application of the sensor and then solving the connectivity problem, which is a big, big part in really remote areas.
Yeah, interesting. Oh, it's nice that you say it's a smoke detector, but actually you kind of fuse all those sensors together and I guess you model the different smoke. Nice. That's really interesting. So I think a big part of your work is really technically focused. So can you maybe tell me a little bit more on so what are the skills required in your field of work?
So there's a couple parts of it, right? Is you know, I grew up in doing electrical engineering work and computer science type work, and I've always tinkered and coded for years. But you know, most of my career was in sales and network architecture and communication architecture and sales engineering or solution architecture, whatever you want to call it. You know, when I was at Cisco and Microsoft, those skills of how to speak with a customer, to have that sales and technical sales type skills to really, we say, peel back the onion and figure out what the true problem is versus just trying to sell a widget that, you know, you might have. And well, you have to try to sell that over and over and over. But if you could really connect with the customer and figure out what the problem is and how might you solve that, then, you know, I always say that, you know, your bag of tricks and your assets are every relationship you've had, every experience you've had in your entire career. So like the way I apply it in this smoke side is, you know, I was a volunteer firefighter for years. I understand smoke. I understand the science and the physiology of it. I understand what firefighters are going through. So, you know, that's for me. Does that help in the conversations I'm having and designing and building a product and speaking with researchers about smoke? Yes, it does. It's credibility, and that's a big skill. Sales skills in general, again, just understanding truly what the customer challenge is in agriculture. Is it water, soil moisture, microweather, frost, disease? Really kind of get into it, but then learn every time you have a conversation. The other side of it is a sensor builder. You have to have the core kind of EE and computer science type skills to really build a product. So what does it take to do circuit board manufacturing, to design a schematic, to build micro software on top of that, to put the right components together? And, you know, right now, if you're a device manufacturer, it's a little bit of a pain because the whole supply chain industry is kind of up in arms. You know, one day you've got your assembly house and the fabrication house for your circuit boards is, we're putting the capacitors now. Oh wait, they're gone. They're out of stock. Great. Now we gotta go find something else.
Exactly.
But, there is for designing a sensor, it's the electrical engineering type skills, schematics, board layout, fabrication. There's plenty of ways to learn and help, and to get help. The other part's the software side, you know, building a small embedded microcontroller and building a stack. And then on the LoRaWAN side, you definitely have to understand the LoRaWAN technology. So understanding the nuances of how to get data out, the RF side, making sure that it's the radios are reliable, the gateways are receiving the frames, it's having good backhaul connectivity to the LNS, et cetera, et cetera. And then, you know, obviously skills for developing the front end application.
Yeah.
It's a little bit of everything. And But yeah,
I sense it indeed. But it's interesting that you say, like, it's not only the technical side. Actually, there's a whole story before you actually start diving into technology. If you at least first narrow down the problem. And yeah, for that, you need social skills. But yeah, it's, I would say it's really impressive what you're doing. And it's a very small team you're working in, but you still manage to get it to work. And you're doing lots of things by hand. And of course, that's one option to go for, really. And I think that's when you dive into those unique problems, then there's not an off-the-shelf solution for that. But yeah, the good side is if you don't really have that knowledge yet of how to design PCBs, how this manufacturing process works, then there are also plenty of sensors that you can choose from in the market already.
Correct. You know, there's definitely, you know, the universal nodes and those development platforms that are just great to be able to start early. So you don't have to focus on all of it. I love doing a little bit of everything. I've always said of the guy with a really large tool belt, never an expert at one thing, but an expert in a lot of little things about an inch deep. But the, you know, with that, it allows you to kind of take that bigger picture and really understand and really to break down what the challenges might be with all those different experiences. But if you just want to be a hardcore microcode writer, then yeah, there's plenty of development platforms to do that and focus on that area, but work with a team that has expertise in the other disciplines.
Yeah.
Because, you know, taking a development platform and getting it certified and getting it out into the market, that's a much different challenge than just developing a cool use case and putting the code on that device and making it work. Doing it at scale is the next big challenge that you all have to come in front of pretty soon. But understanding the challenge and try to do some prototyping early, starting with a dev platform, you know, even with us, we've always tried to start with some dev platforms and I go, well, this is what's good about that dev platform, but this is what I need to do. And if we decide to take that next step and produce our own custom version of it as a product, that's what the dev platforms are there. They're not to commercialize the dev platform into a fully functioning commercial product. It's to get you kickstarted, use the reference and design guides, use every piece of help you can, the forums, the manufacturer themselves, and really dig deep into how much of that core part of the dev platform can you use to just kickstart you forward and get faster, get a product faster to market?
Yeah, indeed. But at least it starts with this development board and just tinkering with sensors and really seeing if you can get valuable data that might already solve the problem at hand. So if you would now direct yourself to the students listening in, this academy. So what would you recommend? What would you suggest on how they can get professionally in this vertical or in this market?
Well, obviously, I mean, you're in a great starting place by already attending the academy. And anytime you follow the Things Industries and the Things Network folks, they put on great content every year. And, you know, we'll have the conference next year as well, and tons of content from folks like us who are out in the field every day. I get on the LoRa Alliance, kind of the industry forum where we're all working together, and you talking to some of these work groups, the integration part is where there's still a gap out there. There's lots and lots of sensors, so you can go build sensors, but understanding a sensor and how it connects to the network, and if the network's not available in the area, to be able to build a network, you know, that's an expertise that we need. We need more integrators that are out there, because unless there's one big worldwide carrier, AT&T decides to say, hey, we're going to put a LoRaWAN everywhere, there's still those regional challenges we're going to have to deal with. So we need more integrators. But one of the challenges, I think, to the students is, if you try to figure out an area you want to focus on, you know, hopefully you're passionate about it. So I got really passionate about agriculture and smart agriculture. And one of the things I see is there's tons and tons of new sensors always coming out. If there's a sensor that's out there already in the market and you're thinking about building yet another soil moisture sensor, there's 50 of them out there already. We don't need a cheap $5 soil moisture sensor. Get it working for your own good and your own learning experience, but the market doesn't need yet another one. What the market is starting to need is, I'd call them kind of transition technologies. So if you take agriculture or environmental monitoring, there are sensors that are out there that are not using LoRaWAN. They're barely even using cellular. They probably have a data logger on it that someone has to collect the logs every month and pull a memory card from. These are sensors to where that agency or that customer, that group might have a decade or two of data already, you know, captured from, say, a soil moisture sensor. What you don't want to do is just take a brand new off-the-shelf cheap little soil moisture sensor and throw it in and say you're going to get the same quality of data as that sensor has been doing for 20 years. So that transition technology is all around, I have a sensor that has been there in the ground for 10 years, provided by a manufacturer. That manufacturer knows nothing about LoRaWAN, but it has SDI 12, it has RS-232, it has RS-485, it has I2C. It has something that there are some devices out there that you can connect to. These dev platforms connect to it. Open libraries like SDI 12 libraries that are out there. Get those, build a device that interrogates that device and connects it to the LoRaWAN network. Because now what you have is these researchers and these farmers with these large data sets of a certain type of sensor, but they want to connect that sensor to a network so you can get data in real time. Get rid of the old data logger out on the edge idea. Let's disaggregate this stuff, make it all wireless. But that transition and building devices that connect to legacy devices is really powerful. If you have a farm that has no sensors in it whatsoever, great. Go take a Tektelec soil moisture sensor. This is the elevated sensor in it, and put some soil moisture probes in it. Great. You can get a great new data set, and that's called a greenfield. But there's a ton of folks who are hesitant on adopting anything brand new because they have very large data sets for years and years of what we call the story in agriculture. It requires a transition technology. So, you know, take a development platform and say, hey, these are four or five different sensors that might be using SDI 12 or RS-485. Let's go build a little transition device, interrogate the device, power it, put it back to sleep, then use the power of LoRaWAN to connect it.
It is really interesting because eventually, like, the LoRaWAN market is relatively young. The technology only exists for a small year. So I don't think any farmer is going to Google for LoRaWAN sensor. But for sure, they have soil moisture sensor, weather station. So if you can find a clever way to get in touch and to add LoRaWAN connectivity to the existing sensors, I think that's a very valuable, very good tip.
Yeah, correct. And that type of, if you look at some of the sensors that are out there, so think of meteorological, so weather station type sensors, soil moisture sensors, leaf wetness, some of that stuff in agriculture or environmental monitoring, they're traditionally wired to a central data logger. We want to disaggregate that with the power of LoRaWAN. And with that, we have to take something that does SDI 12, connect it to a small little transceiver. Exactly. And there's tons of them out there and tons of dev kits. And now you've disaggregated that. You can put that leaf wetness sensor wherever because now it's wirelessly connected. It is great because that resonates with the farmer. Hey, I have the same sensor. Now I can add more of them and I don't have to pay $5,000 for a data logger every time I put another one in or a proprietary wireless technology. Now we're using the power of LoRaWAN.
Yeah, nice. Well, it's a great tip. Thanks for this recommendation. Thanks for taking the time for this interview. So yeah, thanks a lot, Scott. And we might be seeing a little bit more of you later in this course.
You bet. Anytime. Cheers.
Perfect. Thanks, Scott.